Starting, and now we are live. We're officially live. Pete, how are you doing?
Hello. I'm doing well. How are you doing?
Good. All right. Well, now that we're going, why don't we get started with introductions? You can pass the talking pillow. Pete, go.
Absolutely. Well, let's go around. How about if we do the normal left to right here on the show as it shows up on the screen here? Jeremy, why don't you kick it off? Say something about yourself, and we'll move it on down the line.
All right. Oh, that Jeremy or this Jeremy?
you Jeremy.
All right. My name is Jeremy Cowart. I'm a photographer currently living in Nashville, Tennessee. Yep. And I'm a big fan of Trey Ratcliffe, and that's about it.
No, come on. We're all fans of Jeremy Cowart. This is.
Yeah.
We were thinking about calling the show the Jeremy Cowart Worship Hour.
Dude, whatever, man. Whatever. I'm honored to be here, seriously.
Right, well, thanks for joining us. Really appreciate the time. All right, Lisa, how about you?
Oh, hi, I'm Lisa Bettany, and I'm currently living back in my hometown of Victoria, BC, after spending a few years in San Francisco and New York. I'm a photographer, but I'm also an iPhone app developer. I co-founded the app Camera Plus, and now, I don't know. I just kind of travel around and take pictures and enjoy life.
So we've never heard of Camera Plus. Tell us about this app. Yeah. I've never heard of this thing before.
Really?
Is it popular that people downloaded it? I don't know.
I've heard a few people use it from time to time, you know, in between Instagramming things.
Yeah. Okay, Pete, who's next?
Very good. All right, Thomas, let's round it out with you.
Yes, I am Thomas Hawk. You can find me at thomashawk.com or Google Plus or Flickr or Facebook or any of these sites. You can also catch my one-man photography comedy show every Thursday night at the Burbank Ramada Inn.
All right. Hang on.
I'm just kidding.
Welcome to all our guests. And guys, thanks again for taking so much time out of the day to join us here. Just a little bit summary of the show. So today, we've got a great show lined up. We're going to be talking about apps. In fact, Jeremy, you've got one that's gone live recently. I'd love to hear about that. And we're going to talk about all things apps. Also, Trey, I think we're going to talk a little bit about a competition that you ran on the last show. We had a show all about quadcopters last week. We had an all-star cast of guests, and one of them was Colin Gwynn, right, from DJI.
Right.
I think you're giving something away, aren't you?
Oh, yeah. So we have a giveaway. And so to enter the competition, the audience just had to go ahead and enter a comment on the Stuck in Customs blog. And we had thousands of comments, and they were incredible. There was a very wide range. Some incredible ones, very amazing ones, some strange ones, too. Someone said that they were going to use it to track their Amish roadshow. There were many. I don't know, Trey. I know you had a couple too. There was somebody that was going to say they were going to surveil their neighbors, maybe with the quadcopter.
Someone said if they won it, they would fly it into Sarah Palin's mouth.
Yes.
An option that I hadn't considered. Quadcopter.
It's one way to get the job done.
Yeah.
But you have to go to the website to go check them out. There's literally thousands over there. Trey,
yes.
One of them kind of rose at the top.
We definitely picked randomly, but I'm really pleased with this random pick that we got. It was a we're going to try to call her right now because she is the winner. Let me tell you what she said in her thing here.
What was it, Miss Anelia?
No.
Oh.
No, it is not Miss Aniela. It is not. Let me find it here. Sorry. She said in her comments, where is it here? Her name is Carrie Conti. You're the winner, Carrie.
All right.
We're going to try to call you here. She said, now that would let me take pictures where my wheelchair prevents me from reaching. It would be awesome to get one of these to use. Oh, the places we'll go and see. Ah, isn't that nice? So, actually, Curtis randomly selected her, and I'm going to try to call her right now and see if she's right there. All right, I'm going to use Google Hangout
Carrie
technology to call her. So I guess I could just type a phone number into this thing, right? Maybe I can't with on-air. I don't think I can call her.
Are you trying to use Skype?
I know when you do a normal Hangout, you can call like regular phone numbers. I do it all the time, but now when I go to invite someone, it won't let me type in a phone number.
Don't get micro-bricked.
Oh, you know what it is? I bet they can't, like, because all of you guys had to check that box to agree to go on the air. I guess they can't check a box on the phone.
Oh, so, I agree.
Oh, well.
Share your screen and call her on Skype.
I guess I could, but that would... you guys don't want to watch me fumble around with Skype. I just use Google Hangouts now. I don't use Skype so much anymore.
Skype's not as good since Microsoft bought them.
Yeah, it's still pretty popular, though. I know. All right, well, anyway, congratulations, Carrie. You're the winner of this new $1,200 quadcopter. I've got one, too. It's actually in a box on the way to New Zealand now, so I can't wait to start playing with it. It's going to be awesome.
All right,
well, and thanks, everyone, for entering. We had thousands and thousands of entries. It was crazy. And if you want to know more about quadcopters, just go watch last week's show. What else is coming up in today's show, Pete? I have my notes here, but they're off to the side.
Absolutely. Well, the big news was on iPhone apps. We've got another all-star cast to cover a topic like that. And I thought maybe we would start with Jeremy. Jeremy, you've got a new app that just launched recently. I know probably all of us have downloaded and played with it. I know I have. I love it. I think the design is fantastic. It's super simple and fun. It's innovative. But I don't know. I was hoping maybe you could kick us off here and tell us a little bit about the app and get the discussion going.
Sure. It's called OKDOTHIS, and it's basically a community of ideas. And so you can add 140 character thoughts or ideas or a quote or a lyric, anything that other people can translate into visuals or photos. And so all the ideas are based on categories. So street photography, fashion, selfies, we pretty much have every life category possible in the app. And so it really is just about ideas. And so you upload an idea and you watch as others translate your ideas into visuals or photos, and then you do your friends' ideas. We actually call the ideas do's. It's just, part of our name, OKDOTHIS, and it was a fun word to kind of go with. And so, that's kind of how it works. You browse your feed, and under each photo in the feed is the idea, and you can see how many people have done each of your ideas. You can see which of your ideas are most popular. There's lots of other stuff. You can stack your filters in the app. You can, lots of other stuff. It's an exciting time. We just launched 2 weeks ago, and it's been fun to see the photo community embrace it so far.
Right. What was the inspiration for this? I mean, there's so many photo apps out there, but yet we've got this brand new one. It's so different. What was your inspiration?
Oddly enough, I actually had the idea nearly 4 years ago before Instagram even launched. So this has been a long time coming for me. But I think the idea just started with photographers asking me, like when I teach, they say, what do you tell your subjects? How do you know what to do? How do you know what to say? And so I just thought, there should be an app for that. And for a little while, it was going to be like a lame Jeremy Cowart app with my ideas of what I tell my subjects. But then I realized that I have like three ideas. So why don't I make this a community-based thing where everybody can dump ideas into the same pool? And that's where the idea was born, and we've been working on it ever since for a very long time.
I have to ask one more question. I've been dying to know. What's one of the funniest ideas or do's you've seen submitted so far?
Gosh, there's some. We already have thousands, but one of the ones that I put into the app that I've been laughing at the photos of is one of the ideas I put in there. This is really mean, but we made one for men too, but we made one for women that says, tell a woman to smile, then immediately tell her her thighs look big, and then capture the reaction. But then we made some for men too, so it's all about capturing a reaction. So we said tell a man to smile, then ask him if he's gained weight, and capture the reaction. So it's hilarious to browse through the do and to see all these women giving the camera these nasty looks.
I want to use that thighs one with Trey though.
You should ask me if something else looks big.
Oh,
yeah.
That's awesome.
Hey,
yeah, go ahead.
Jeremy, when you launched it, it like shot up into the top 10, didn't it? That's pretty amazing to get up in the top 10.
Yeah, we reached number 4 on launch day, which is exciting, obviously.
Wow.
And that was in the entire App Store, so that was super exciting. Obviously, we've fallen down since then. But they featured us last week as a best new app, and we think they're about to do another feature. So, yeah, it's fun to, you know, be in the beginning of this process. The photo community has really, really embraced it so far. I think before we launched, people were worried about this being about stealing ideas, like, oh, great, now we're just borrowing each other's ideas. And I think once you get the app and look through it, it's not really ideas. It's more like prompts. You know, it's more like anything to get a conversation started. So like last night, I made a very simple do that said, fill the frame with a circle, any circle. And so, you know, since then, tons of images have flooded in that are just simple circles. So that's not like some idea that I'm worried about somebody stealing. I mean, it's very simple. It's really just about the community coming together. I love seeing, you know, competition walls break down. This industry is so competitive, and so it's been really refreshing to see people embrace the community spirit of it versus the competitive, you know, thing we usually do.
I always find Billy Wilson steals my best ideas.
He does. He's, that's why it's called the Canadian vacuum. Well, there's two reasons for that, but that's just one of them.
Hey, Jeremy, I'll tell you, I'll ask this question, but then I'd love to hear, Lisa, from you as well, just with the app experience and so forth. But just getting an app out there, number one. Number two, getting it marketed or getting some awareness driven around is number three. Number three, getting it up to the top 4 spot. Are there some tips or tricks or lessons learned that you could share maybe with, you know, how does something like that happen? Is it just from the awesomeness of the app or...
I'll let Lisa answer that one because she stays in the top 10. I only peaked in the top 10 for a second, so
you can tell us how to stay. Pass the talk pillow around.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, for us, I don't think anyone really remembers our start, but we got into the top 10 and then we immediately dropped right after. And we actually had to change the app because there were some problems with it, and we actually refreshed the app and kind of relaunched it again to get it back up. But it is a constant. I mean, once you get into that, where you're like checking every day, where's my app? But I think for what's exciting about your app is that sort of inspiration angle. And I think for any new app that's coming out there, it can't just be here's an app, here's some filters. It has to be more. And I think the most exciting thing for me with Camera Plus is really promoting creativity. Like, I love it when I see someone use my app in a creative way, someone who otherwise wouldn't take photos. And I think with your app, it's fun because it gives people who don't really have these ideas in their head, like, the, you know, they're new to photography or they're just sitting there not knowing what to do, and you give them that initial prompt.
Mm. Yeah, it's been really fun. Like, people are saying that, you know, that for the first time in a decade, their creativity has been refreshed. People are just saying they're feeling alive again. So it's certainly like amazing to be a part of something that's helping people just feel alive. You know, photography aside, just something that's inspiring people. So that's the goal of anything that I'd like to be a part of. So we're definitely excited.
Hey, Thomas, where do you think mobile phone photography is headed? I mean, I love this angle. Just when we thought, like Jeremy's saying and Lisa's saying, what else can you do? And then we have something innovative and fun like this. Where do you see some of the mobile phone photography going?
You know, I mean, I'm completely blown away and impressed with so many mobile photographers. You know, Koki Hernandez is a guy on Instagram. He does all kinds of crazy stuff. He shoots just with his iPhone. And I've just been, you know, I see some of these people that are doing stuff. My buddy Michael Ventry, who goes by Velicor on Instagram. I mean, Instagram is exploding. I mean, we already all know that, but I mean, everybody's on there, and not just as a publishing platform, but as the processing tools. I mean, Snapseed is great, boy, and VSCOcam and all these apps. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've just, you know, I was on Android for a long time. I switched to an iPhone back, but I've been on the last two, my two phones before this one were Android. And so I kind of missed out on some of the Instagram stuff because it wasn't available for Android for a while. But, boy, I mean, I think the photo processing stuff, I'm trying to process and post, like, you know, one photo or so a day of Instagram, and I'm doing it only mobile, and I'm doing it only photos processed on the mobile phone, and I think it's big.
Yeah, I agree. Snapseed is awesome, and I'm still constantly amazed at Instagram. But I remember, Thomas, you once said that you didn't have time for Instagram. You're like one of these people, oh, I don't know who it's. Ain't nobody got time for that. Now you're on Instagram all the time.
I know. I went on. I shot Route 66 with my buddy Daniel Krieger, and he is like an Instagram elite, I guess. He posts something up there, and it's like 1,000 likes, and he's a food photographer for the New York Times, and he was just obsessed the whole trip with Instagram. He's like, oh, I've got to Instagram these tamales. I can't leave here until we Instagram them. And it was a lot of food stuff, and I don't know. It seemed really, really fun, and I think that kind of got me into it a little bit.
I'm probably the only person not on Instagram.
I was going to mention another photographer. I really love this guy, Kevin Russ, R-U-S-S, and he's on Instagram, but he's also got a Tumblr site. If you Google him, he's great. It's all, everything is done on an iPhone. You know, Lisa and Jeremy, you guys are learning a lot about the mobile photographer. Do we see the gap widening in between folks that are going to be, you know, strictly on DSLR? Do we see it shrinking and narrowing, and it's becoming, you know, almost interchangeable just because it's just one more tool? What do you guys think about that kind of trend, or what are your thoughts?
Go ahead, Lisa.
A lot of photographers I know who are working photographers, they will, I've been shooting with them, and they'll take a shot on their DSLR and then a shot on their iPhone. Because I think for most photographers, immediacy of a response is really important. And if you see something so incredible, you just have this desire to share it. And you know, sometimes you can't get the best shot with your iPhone. You need, you know, a long exposure or something like that. So maybe you capture that. But maybe you capture the moment, you know, setting up your tripod or something incredible that you've seen. And I think for a lot of professional photographers, they're using them in that sort of symbiosis or whatever. And I think for most people who are just starting, I think they'll immediately take photos on their iPhone because it's a device that they have. You know, everyone has a mobile phone, so they can start shooting right away. You know, and it's something that's affordable for a lot of people versus buying, you know, $10,000 worth of gear. So it's a nice entry point to start creating things and start exploring photography.
Yeah, there's a...
We should remind people, Jerry, right before you go, that you can, if you want to ask any questions, just pop them into the event page. And we're kind of watching. There's sort of like a live chat room in a way too. So pop questions on there. And also at the end of the show, after we get through this topic, we're gonna have everyone share some of their recent photos. And I'm gonna share some photos of this new Sony I got. And also I want to introduce you to this guy in case you don't know him, named Benjamin Von Wong. This incredible photographer. And he just jumped onto our radar because actually everyone in here, we're all in the Arcanum together. We're all kind of masters in the Arcanum, and he applied to be a master. And this guy's work is just incredible. When you see it, you'll be totally shocked. So, Pete, don't let me forget to show his stuff either, okay?
Absolutely. Gotcha.
Okay. Go ahead, Jeremy.
Yeah, I've got this this theory right now. I don't blog, but I did actually write a very short blog post on the topic. But I feel like there's something much bigger than photography that's really bringing people into mobile photography. Mm-hmm. And this is a bit of an explanation. But basically, I feel like a lot of people have really boring jobs and things that they don't feel they get much attention. You know, we all want to be seen and we all want to be heard. But most people in their everyday lives, in their everyday jobs, they don't get that attention. And so what happens is that people come home and they, you know, post their photos on Instagram and Flickr and wherever else, and they get this amazing, like, oh my gosh, you have such a great eye, you're incredible, this photo's epic, OMG, you know, and they start thinking that, oh man, like, I'm getting attention on my phone on Instagram, and I don't get it anywhere else, and so maybe I should be a photographer. And so the next thing you know, people have, you know, the word photographer on their Twitter bio. They're shooting all the time. They shoot their first wedding. And I can't blame them. I very much welcome them as a pro. I think it's healthy. But I just think it's almost like the new rock star thing to do is to be a photographer. And so I think there's going to be thousands and thousands and thousands of people just coming on in, if not daily, weekly, you know, just coming into the photography arena. So, yes, of course, it's going to get more and more competitive. Of course, it's going to be becoming more and more mobile. And if I were the big DSLR creators, I would definitely be very scared. They better figure out how to turn their DSLRs into phones. Yeah, that's kind of my personal theory on why so many people are, you know, really jumping into the photography world.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's that feedback, the fast creative feedback loop that people finally feel creative. Like you said, maybe they're in a job that doesn't value their creativity or they're not allowed to use it, but of course everyone's creative inside, even if it's gotten squashed down over the years. And you know, even if you're a good writer, it actually takes a little while to write something, and it takes even longer for people to consume what you've written, so it's not like immediately accessible. And we're such visual creatures that, you know, a picture is just like sort of instant creativity that is instantly understandable by the person that sees it without them having to spend, you know, 30 minutes to read a short story, or, you know, or even sit there and muse on one of your poems or whatever it might be. So it's just a way, a very human way, I think, to share your creativity and get some sort of positive feedback from the global hive mind.
You can express that emotion through that picture, right? I mean, very quickly. Thomas, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, the other thing that Instagram's done that's really smart, though, is they've really kind of fine-tuned their app for social. I mean, tap to fave a photo and like it is just so easy, and everybody's got an extra 10 minutes at the bus stop, and they're just flipping through and tap, and all these other sites where people can share mobile photography, it seems like, you know, and their activity pages, which are just, it really encourages almost sort of like instantaneous reaction to a photo. So I think when people put stuff up there, all of a sudden it gets noticed right away, whereas they might put it on Flickr or Facebook or Google Plus or someplace else, and it doesn't quite get that sort of immediate little rush. And I think people are kind of addicted to that. I think, Jeremy, you're right. People like that feeling of, hey, look, somebody appreciated me. Someone likes my stuff.
I think one of the other areas that has been really eye-opening for me is with mobile photography, you get the benefit of the cloud also. Not just do you have this very compact, high-performance camera, but now it's connected up to the cloud. So, you know, a better camera is one more app update away. And next thing you know, maybe there's a feature available. Like I know with Google Plus Photos, they launched a new update. You shake your phone, you get snow on your image now. And so what a great way to get, you know, folks to consume from the business side, I think. What a great way to be able to get people to re-engage with your product, right, is to start putting in capabilities that are going to have them engage in a very real way, real physical way.
Well, and that's part of Snapseed, too. I mean, I think... Yeah. It's amazing to me when mobile photography first came out, you know, I kind of played around with some early things with Photoshop and, you know, some really crude filters, and even Instagram's first filters were just, you know, basically you click on a thing and that's what you get. But boy, I mean, I've been pretty impressed with the processing tools for a phone from Snapseed. I mean, that's just, for stuff that's not meant to be blown up and printed large and all that, they've got, you know, it seems like they keep rolling that stuff out. The HDR filter, all that stuff is pretty good for the phone.
It's incredible. It's super intuitive. It's fast. I love using it on my tablet even. You know, the thing that's been blowing me away lately isn't really, I guess it wouldn't qualify as an app, but it's this Auto Awesome movie from Google Plus, because now every day, Every day I pull this down, right? You know, this is, if you have an Android you kind of pull down from the top, and you get your little updates. And every day down there, I have this Google Plus Auto Awesome movie that's made. And like, so these, I don't know if you can see this, but these are like highlight reels from my past 4 days. So at the end of every day, it takes all the photos that I took with my mobile phone or with glass and all the little movies I made, and then it makes a little 3-minute highlight reel of my day and sets it to music. And as I'm sitting there watching it, I just swipe my finger, just like Instagram, and it gets like a different look, like an 8mm look or a vintage look or a cartoonish look or whatever it is.
It plays music while you do it?
It plays music. It does the cuts right to the beats of the music. It is unbelievable.
So cool. Is that iPhone or Android, Trey?
Android, brother. Actually, I don't think it matters. I don't know. As long as you put your stuff on Google Plus, I think they auto awesome movie gift you every day.
I don't get those auto awesome videos on my iPhone though.
It's funny though. The song they keep choosing for Trey's day is that "What Does the Fox Say" thing.
Yeah. But I think that, Trey, that goes right to what I was saying, which is the capability of the phone goes so far, but then you've got the cloud, which is virtually unlimited in the capabilities. You start tying these two things together, creates a whole new world. I think, not to drag conversation too off, but I think this spells, you know, a whole new future for the more casual photographer to be able to enter. It lowers that barrier, right? They don't need to go out and buy photo management software. It's all being handled in the cloud. And then they get the vignettes and the highlight reels that they need without having to lift a finger. Just it makes it so much easier and less stressful to share.
Good point, Pete. Well said.
Okay. All right. All right. So where is this going? So we're talking about some cool things that we have today, but Thomas, like, what are the top two things you'd love to see in either a mobile app or in just a camera capability or something joined up at the hip on the cloud to make the mobile photography experience better?
Well, one thing that I think is that, I think that a lot of times people are mobile and they're on mobile, but sometimes people are on the web. And I think that the interface for sites like Instagram on the web are terrible. They're just awful compared to other things. And I think the other problem is, and somebody mentioned in the chat room and the event that, there's all these sites. There's Google Plus and there's Flickr and there's Facebook and there's Instagram. And, how do you choose one? And what do you do? And where do you go? And where do you post your stuff? And these paid sites and Behance and 500px and all this stuff. I think we need to have a better way to consume photos both on the web and on the phone both. But I think we need to figure out a way, how do you use like APIs and stuff like that to aggregate and create just a pure wall of photos, just a pure photo experience that kind
regardless of where it's coming from.
Right. Yeah. I mean, forget about these borders, photos without borders, just
there you go. Let's make it the app. Let's go.
Right. I think you could create a website and it could be actually something very simple, just a wall of photos.
We should call it Photos Without Borders and Photos Without Watermarks.
Yes, no watermarks allowed.
Used to be a site called Flick River, like Flickr River.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you guys have ever seen that. Something similar, but you like add in Twitter, Pinterest, add in 500px and so forth, and just get that stream.
I want to see, like I want to just take my day and say, okay, I've got a half an hour here. I just blow me away, Internet.
Yeah.
Show me, like, these really great things without watermarks.
What I would like is the algorithm that shows me the best photos, not the most popular photos. Because oftentimes there's an incredible photographer, but he has 5 followers. So he might get 5 likes and we keep seeing Justin Bieber's photos. And I don't know. I mean, he's a great guy. He's Canadian. But enough's enough. I think I'm not on Instagram, and one of the reasons I'm not is because when I go to what's popular there, it drives me insane. I don't want to see people's bums and, who's the popular, celebrity of the day. I just want to see great photos and creative things. And so I've been using 500px because I think it's just amazing. Like, it's the best photos that I've seen, and I'm really inspired by the photographers on there. And I think they've come up with a really exciting algorithm that promotes the best photos, regardless of how many followers or how popular a person is. But something like that for all the sites, because, you know, since I've been on 500px, I haven't been on Flickr. I just kind of abandoned it, and I kind of miss the people that are using that. And it'd be great to just to have this photo wall, but to have the interestingness that Flickr used to have and doesn't really have anymore.
You know, Flickr has a lot of stuff that's buried underneath. Part of the problem, I think, with Flickr is that their explore page, first of all, it bans a lot of different people from it, so that's problematic. But a lot of the real interesting, edgy stuff gets kind of filtered out, I think. They don't want to, you know, they don't want to show it. It's too sanitized, I think.
Well, but I generally agree with, though, Lisa, because I'm always surprised and shocked at how amazing the stuff is on 500px. It's just, it's shocking, the art and the how much talent there is out there. Here's a good tip. If you guys have iPads or whatever, get that 500px app. It is unbelievable, and you can put it like into the slideshow mode. You know, if you sit there with your iPad plugged in, and just set it up on the desk, and it will just show you like the best photos of the day. It'll just cycle through them, and it's just nice just to look over there every now and then. We need a little distraction. Like, oh my God, look at that ridiculous photo. it's guaranteed gold with that site and that app. And Andre's doing a great job. Oh, they're all doing a great job over there.
That's one of the things we're excited about with OKDOTHIS is we have a whole editorial section called Discover. And Lisa, we made it for the same reasons you're talking about. Like, I don't want a popular section where it's all Justin Bieber and cleavage and, you know, coffee and sunsets. And so we are slowly building an editorial team that literally is picking not only the best photos, but the best ideas, the most funny ideas, the most creative ideas. And we have different sections. Like right now, we currently have, you know, holidays, music and lyrics. We have, we're adding a travel thing right now. We just had Thanksgiving. So there will always be these changing, almost like a magazine in our Discover section, because we're finding that's where everybody's spending their time, is not browsing the feed. I mean, they do browse their feed, obviously, but the where they're spending their time is browsing what we're curating. And so it's going to be really fun to build that out. Like right now, we've got we discovered a 16-year-old photographer in Buffalo, New York, named Alex, I think Curry, and this kid is like brilliant. And so it's been cool. We've now featured him, and he's already got, you know, 600 followers this week. And I'm sure as a 16-year-old kid in Buffalo, like, that's an incredible thing. And so I'm very excited to be able to really empower these new brilliant photographers and to show the rest of the world, like, this is where the real talent is. I mean, obviously, we want people like yourselves on there as well, photo influencers, but we're very excited to really feature the unknowns out there and the beautiful images that really don't get enough credit.
You know, I think another big opportunity for mobile and for the web is sort of trip planning type stuff. Like when I go shoot stuff, I just got back from shooting Route 66 and this, you know, in part of, you know, Stuck on Earth with Trey's app, which I think this is why stuff technology like that's going to be really, really valuable, because, you know, you go and you want to go someplace and there's so much noise of all these photos online and there's so many bad photos of like a place. And if you search on Google Image Search or even Flickr, a lot of times they're just not that good. But how do I find like a nice curated, like, I want to go to Death Valley. I want to shoot the best stuff in Death Valley. Or even just say I'm not a photographer. I just want to go and see the greatest stuff. So, you know, I think there's going to be specific stuff that's oriented towards travel, that's oriented towards places, like Stuck on Earth. I think that stuff's going to be big, too.
Well, thank you for the plug for my free app. Jeremy's app is not free, but everyone should go pay it with all the money they're saving with Stuck on Earth. Now, Thomas, you got to use your Flickr contacts. I know you're over there. You're always, you know, having wine and cheese with Marissa. But next time you guys are just hanging out on a yacht, or you back your yacht up against the Prince of Monaco's yacht so you can have a double party barge, bring this up. We need access, we need them to fix their API, because what Stuck on Earth does, we're trying to pull like the best photos ranked on interestingness, which Flickr does an amazing job of, but we want to exclude certain kinds of photos. Like, we don't want to show photos of, like, dogs or models or,
right.
You know, there's a lot of stuff we want to exclude, because every now and then you zoom in, you just get a picture of, like, a model or a cute dog, and that doesn't actually help you get to know the area. It's a very simple thing they could fix in their API.
They could.
It
drives me crazy as well. I remember when I was going to shoot Austin, and I was looking up on Flickr for photos on Austin and by interestingness, and there were all these photos by this guy named Matt Austin of Idaho. And I don't want to see Matt Austin's photos of Idaho. I'm going to Austin. I want to see pictures of Austin to see what I want to shoot there. And I couldn't get rid of them. I was stuck. Yeah, Flickr's their search capabilities need work, and so does the API.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right. What about just on the travel thing? If you are going a little bit light, one of the questions that popped up here in our chat window here, or excuse me, from the Q&A section, was a question from the audience around, you know, when we are traveling. Thomas, you go out on Route 66. I don't know, how long were you out there for that?
5 days.
5 days. All right. So yeah. That's a, you know, you're moving on that. You're trying to capture the whole thing.
Yeah.
What do you do? So one of the questions was more of a gear question,
yeah.
But something around, how do you make sure you're getting good color calibration done, right?
Color
to make sure that you're accurate when you're in the field.
I don't worry about color. That's, you do that in processing. That's post-production stuff.
Yeah. Well, I think it's part of the, you know, that's part of the question is, you know, if you're concerned about it, I think you expand the question to, you know, when you're going to go out somewhere for a 5-day jaunt, you're trying to travel light, what are some of the things you guys do to kind of make it simpler, make it easier, make it faster to capture those images?
Well, I don't do anything because I use these MacBook Pros, which just have unbelievable color calibration. I mean, maybe after 3 or 4 years, it'll fade one direction or the next, but you don't even really need to calibrate these Macs. They're unbelievable.
And they have like an internal tool to calibrate them too, if you want to use it. I've used that before, my MacBook Pro, but I'm with Trey. I mean, I don't worry about that.
And if you have a PC, you can use something like a Color Monkey or something if you're real worried about the colors being off. But, you know, there's a lot of color calibration nerds out there who will just like pound this into how important it is, and there's whole forums dedicated to it. But if your color's just a little bit off, my theory, and actually this is probably a fact, that your eye just adjusts, you know, your blues might be pushed in one direction, your greens, your oranges, your reds, but your internal, your brain, your retina, your retinex in between, it will adjust. As long as it's not too far off, you know, you're gonna be okay. You probably don't want to do like serious printing type stuff if it's a really old monitor and you're worried about it, but otherwise you're okay. Do you worry about color calibration at all, Jeremy or Lisa?
To be honest, lately I've been doing a lot of landscape photography, and I've noticed how incredibly different it is. Like, mainly it's the darks, like the shadows look really different on my iMac and on my MacBook Air and on my phone. And, you know, I kind of worry, oh, what does this person see? Does everyone see something different? But then it's kind of like if you have a certain laptop, that's what you're used to seeing. So everything might be brighter. Everything might be, I don't know, it's kind of a losing battle because everyone has something different. So I guess you just hope that you have a good eye and that you can see color. And that, I think it's something, as you become a better photographer, it's something you see. You're like, that looks yellow, that looks blue. I mean, I'm starting to print my work, but I think for Jeremy it's much more important since his work is actually going in major publications and such.
If people ever tell me on my photo that I got the color calibration wrong, I just blame it on the Trey Ratcliffe Lightroom presets.
And then you block them.
Yes, block them.
Yeah. You know, we should have a feature of the show every week, Thomas, where we go through like your top 10 blocks of the week.
That's a good idea. I could come up with 10 right now.
I bet you could. All right, Jeremy, what do you do for color calibration?
Man, I am so not the technical guy. I mean, I'm kind of like you. Like, I love my Macs, and colors look pretty good. I mean, I've had, over the years, there's a guy in town in Nashville that does, like, professional monitor calibration, and he's come out a couple times, but it's probably been 3 years since he last came out. I mean, I'm like, you know, I get it loosely dialed in and I'm okay with it. I'm not the anal killer guy, sadly. And I've actually never had a single client, you know, complain or had any real print issues. I don't know. I'm just not that.
Has anyone asked for like a bit more of a tan?
What's that?
maybe some Guido jersey tan. Just pump up the.
I resemble that remark.
Yeah, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Okay, well, we're just going to call Jeremy now the anal color guy. write that down.
That gives me a really terrible visual, but let's keep moving.
It's noted. All right, so I want to cover this off because I don't think we've explored a little bit on the. I want to go back to the mobile and the apps because I think there's more to do there. I wonder from you guys, have you guys ever played with the Nokia, the Lumia, the 40 megapixel camera? I mean, that's getting close to kind of the professional grade camera, right? Have you guys ever tried that one?
I don't want to get micro-bricked.
What's that?
That's when you buy some Microsoft product. Oh. And it doesn't have any apps for it at all.
Oh, right. But just use it as a camera.
I need the processing apps.
I use that Nokia 40 megapixel. It's kind of cool, but I don't know. I don't know if it's for me. One thing that it did that really shocked me was that its built-in photo app was pretty robust. So you take a picture, mm-hmm. and you can actually like take a series of pictures. And I take that back. So you take a picture, and what it does is it actually takes like 15 pictures, and you just see them kind of like a deck of cards going. It's like, whoa, what's happening? And then so it shows you like the best picture. If there's motion in it, it combines them all into like one where they're ghosted, like that thing Auto Awesome does. It'll like automatically make panorama. It makes every possible version of a photo just from one photo, which I thought was kind of a cool thing. And you would think like a 40 megapixel camera, wow, you can really like zoom in and see Mars. But you know, you zoom in and you're like, okay, you know, I could get that with my DSLR, and then maybe you can just go just a little bit further. So it's not that. There's some point of diminishing returns, I think, with megapixels, where you know another 10 megapixels on top of 30 isn't actually that much more resolution.
Yeah, I was at the Nokia launch event for that phone, and I got to really really test it out, and I was blown away by some of the features. You know, I really got to do direct comparisons against my iPhone, and I think the camera's amazing. I'm a fan. I mean, I do agree with you, Trey, that, like, I don't know. I mean, you know, they really are bragging about the zooming capabilities, and it's like you definitely see this kind of nasty digital grain once you zoom in. But to have a 107-inch file at, you know, 72 dpi is pretty amazing from a camera. I mean, if I could put that camera and that software on my iPhone, I would be, like, in hog heaven, you know, mm-hmm. but I'm still such an iOS guy. I love my iPhone that, you know, I only use it every once in a while to play with or to shoot. But I am very impressed by the camera and by the software. I shoot a lot with Phase 1 80 megapixel camera. That's a whole different, you know, it's a whole different beast. Now, that thing is amazing at 100%. But yeah, the Lumia, it's showing promise, I'll say that.
Well, as app developers, I'll go, Lisa, as an app developer, what do you wish you would see or you could have in mobile phones from Android and iOS perspective that would give you an opportunity to make more coolness and awesomeness?
I think just better lenses. And I mean, if Apple would give us access to all the stuff that they're using, their HDR capabilities and that kind of thing, like if they would give that... like if they would allow developers to actually use the stuff instead of, you know, kind of having to go around and figure out a different way to do that. I mean, we obviously were part of one of the biggest scandals with the volume snap button, like using the volume button as a trigger. And so we know that you can't really go against Apple in that way. But there's a lot of stuff that they have that they're not sharing with third-party developers. And I mean, I guess that's a plus for Android. It's just when you've been on the platform for as long as, you know, our team has, it's really difficult to switch over. I mean, you can't just switch over. It's hard enough to keep up. I mean, we're working round the clock just to put out, you know, a build for before Christmas, and, you know, it might not get there. Like, it's tough. So I think that would make anything that allows us to, like, say, a macro. Like, that would be great if you could actually get, like, close enough to do. And then, you know, just fixing, like, better noise reduction. And, like, you know, how do you – it's such a hard thing to do. Like, even clarity for us. Like, we have a clarity button that we created so long ago. And stuff like that takes years in development just to figure out one little tweak that makes a photo better. So I think that would be lovely.
Yeah, I think Google and Android, I've read they're re-engineering the camera from the ground up, and I think we'll see some really interesting stuff from these guys soon. I'm hardcore Android now. I like my iPhone okay, but I'm pretty hardcore Android.
The rumor is we're going to get RAW with Android, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's, you know, because Lisa's right. Actually, what comes into the phone, it's all their kind of firmware that runs through it and then gives you a JPEG. Yeah. But if you get access to that original light that's hitting the sensor, app developers could do a lot with that. And the thought is that, you know, we could do more with it than Apple or whatever this interpolation layer is doing.
Jeremy, what about you? It's holiday season. What's on your wish list from the... phone manufacturers, software, services, hardware, what would you love to see so you could do more with OKDOTHIS?
Gosh, that's a good question. Probably a lot of what's already been said. I mean, we're, you know, for us it's pretty simple. We really are not as concerned with the camera and the optics or any of that stuff. I mean, we're just interested in how people can share among each other and participate in ideas. We really think this is a new thing. I mean, I'm a big fan of apps. I'm a big VSCO Cam user. Obviously, I've loved Camera Plus and Snapseed. But yeah, we're more about just the community idea and sharing of ideas. And so the camera, it's like, you know, we have decent camera capabilities, but yeah, it's just not a big thing for us.
So. Trey, you've showed me a bunch of the cool apps from Android. One of them was you just took a bunch of pictures and then it stitched together like a 3D kind of thing.
Yeah, that's Photosphere. That's kind of one of the default things. It's with the basic camera. Yeah, I think that's just kind of the beginning of a lot of stuff that's gonna come out soon.
Well, what about you and Thomas? What would you like to see in terms of, again, software, services, hardware on that mobile platform?
Well, I want to see... go ahead, Thomas.
No, you go ahead. You go ahead. I have to think about that question.
Yeah. Well, I like...
I'm still thinking about that question. You stumped me on that one.
Yeah. I like... I love Snapseed. I mean, basically, that's all I need. I'm really happy with Snapseed. There's a couple things I want to see, some robustness around Snapseed. I'd like to see the same functionality that's on the phone also on the web. You think it'd be easier on the web. I guess it just takes development time. The other thing is that... And this is a high-grade problem, frankly. But I'd like to be able to take my Google Glass photo and then, like, be Snapseeding it on my phone almost immediately. Yeah. Because, you know, you can't do complex maneuvers with manipulating photos inside the Glass because you just don't have that interface quite yet.
You probably want that to go back to your Glass so you can share it then too, right?
That's right. Well, I could share just on the phone as long as... But anyway, I would like to have some sort of an effortless workflow because, like, it's not too hard to get from your Glass to your phone, but, you know, it kind of has to bounce off the Google server, so on and so forth, and there's a little bit of back and forth there. Because, like, I get really good photos with my Glass, and I want to share them right away, but I think, oh, if I could just tweak it just a little bit. Because, you know, just a few tweaks, you can really go a long way with your photos. I just want a little bit more... control there, so that's sort of on my wish list.
Right on.
Thomas? I think what I would like is a couple things. One, I love Snapseed. Like everybody here, it's my number one go-to app for photo processing on the phone.
Yeah.
I'd like a little bit more strength in noise reduction on Snapseed. I mean, they've got some some structure sliders, and they've got some interesting ambient light and shadows that you can screw around with. But a lot of those functions tend to produce noise in the photo. And I'd love to see, you know, some of the great work that Adobe's done with noise reduction in Lightroom in the last few years. I'd like to see some sort of noise reduction filters for color, for luminance, for, you know, different things like that. And then I think I would also like to see, and this is maybe just unique to me, and this may be also fly in the face of some of these privacy concerns and stuff, but I would like to see better ways to use both Google Glass and my phone kind of in stealth mode or in easier mode in street photography. You know, right now it's so cumbersome to have to pull out a phone and aim it at somebody and shoot that. And even with Google Glass, you know, you got to reach up to turn it on and you got to do, you know, and there's the winky thing that Trey helped me set up. What is that called, Trey?
There's two versions. There's Winky and there's a secret one called Trey Burst. I think I gave you the Trey Burst.
Oh, Trey Burst. I mean, that's kind of cool.
It takes five photos.
Right, but even like sitting there, you're like on the BART train and you're like 3 feet from somebody's face and it's like the perfect street photograph and you just don't want to wink right at them, you know. So it's kind of like, I would love to see more kind of, I mean, why can't I just turn my Google Glass on and just let it record? You know, just let it go. And then
some of us don't even have Google Glass, so I have to use a big camera or something.
Right. Well, in the same thing with the phone. I mean, in some ways, it's almost easier to take stealthy photos with the phone. And I'm not talking about any like sort of bad photos or things like that. These are, you know, street photography. You know, you want to get this sort of cutting edge street scene, and you're right there. And you know, I don't know. I would just, you know, even right now with my iPhone, you know, there's no way to turn, unless I turn all the sound off on my phone. I can't turn off that stupid shutter sound.
Well, you know what you could do? You could make it super stealthy is use that headset, and you can use that volume button on the headset, so you don't even have to, you know, go
can you
and try
do
to
that?
Get your...
Can you do that on an iPhone?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, I'll have to try that.
Trey, what about in the audience there, is anybody asking or suggesting things that
well,
they
I
want to
ask the audience problem? Something. I want to ask them something. They're smart enough to figure this out. I heard about, I don't know if it's on Kickstarter or something like that, but it's a camera that's, I guess, a little bit like Google Glass, except you wear it like a necklace or something. It's got a little camera there. But what it does is it's constantly recording all day long, but like in 5-minute loops, okay? And so usually you don't realize something's interesting until after it happened. Like Thomas was saying, like, oh, this was a really good moment. There's someone interesting across from me on the subway or whatever. So anyway, what it does, as soon as you see something interesting, you just click a button, and it saves the previous 5 minutes into a chunk. And it starts another 5 minutes. So I think that's a really clever idea. So maybe someone can find that thing. That's a good idea.
That is crazy because I was in Africa 8 years ago, and I was with a band. And one of the band members said, we were all talking about inventions, and he said, if I can invent something, I mean, kid you not, this is maybe even longer, maybe 9 years ago. He said, I would invent a pair of glasses that just records, kid you not, every 5 minutes. So that if you see a wreck or an accident or something interesting, you can stop and go back and save that clip. Isn't that crazy? He predicted the future.
Yeah. Maybe he's the guy that started the Kickstarter. You never know. Could be the same African guy. Yeah. Seriously.
But I think, Thomas, I think it will work. I think eventually it will record everything, and then you'll still get that highlight reel like Trey gets on his Android.
Well, I mean, it should, but I think the problem is already there's some of this anti-privacy stuff, position against Google Glass. There have been a couple stories in the past couple of weeks with, you know, Nick Starr getting thrown out of a cafe up in Seattle and this and that. That was on CNBC TV earlier this week, you know, that whole story, and they had the guy on there, and he's like, yeah, I'm not going to let people wear Google Glass in my cafe, and they just can't do it, you know. And so I think, you know, I think Google's kind of almost – by design made it sort of that in order to photograph people, it has to be somewhat obvious. And I don't know if there's sort of the societal will almost to, like, although somebody's got to hack it and somebody's got to figure out a way to say, okay, well, yeah, here you go. Record 24/7 if you want.
Here we go. I found it. Well, I didn't find it. The audience found it. I think actually Von Wong's the guy that got it. It's called the Memento. This is it. That's what it looks like. It hangs around your neck and does that little 5-minute thing. Yeah. they were only trying to get 50,000 and they raised over 500,000.
Jeez.
Crazy. Now that's life recording, or is that, that's not life casting, right? That's life recording.
No, I think it just records it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Well, then you'll be able to connect that with Bluetooth to your Google Glass, and then tether to your phone and show the world the the 5-minute history loop via Hangout.
should we share photos now, Pete?
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah, you're right on it, man. I was just about to say, I was hoping we could start going around the horn here, start sharing some photos.
Hey, before we share, I want to show two things. One is I want to show people Benjamin Von Wong, because he applied to be a master. And we kind of have this little private community currently where all the masters that are in, we're kind of getting our videos ready and, you know, all the masters making like 5 little videos or whatever, and I'm currently working on one. This is the new Sony here, and you can see there is I have a Leica lens on there. So I have two videos that I'm working on. One where I'm trying all kinds of different Leica lenses on here, because you know this is a full frame camera, so tiny. Look at that thing when you put it back to my human sized head. And this is actually a huge Leica lens as far as Leica lenses go. This one is a, I think it's a 70 prime. Well, they're all prime. But yeah, so I'm making some videos with this. But I just saw that Lisa uploaded one. I can't play your video, Lisa, but I'm going to show a screenshot of it. Are you ready? Okay. Screen share, where is it? It's right here. All right, Lisa, while I have this up, tell us what's in this video.
Well, I'm pretty new to the world of landscape and nature photography, so I've since coming home after living in New York for a year, I've been just getting out into the bush and getting my feet wet, photographing streams, and so this was kind of this really cool spot that I found where I'm doing some long exposures of a stream here, and it was very cold. It never snows here, so I was really excited and also very unprepared when I actually stepped into the water in boots that were not waterproof. Lesson learned.
Yeah, it looks like, well, in that scene, it makes it look like it snows all the time there. It looks like a snowy wonderland.
I wish, yeah.
You're so color coordinated with your hat and your.
Oh, I try.
Okay, now, so we opened up applications for the Arcanum just during the last show, and the response has been absolutely unbelievable. Like, we had a target we wanted to get to, like in 6 weeks when we actually launched, but like we blew through it in 24 hours. So response has been crazy, so thanks everyone for the enthusiasm and believing in us, and you know, we got to get our act together and make this thing happen. We take it very seriously. You know, not everyone likes it. There's a lot of controversy, especially from like old school educational type systems that have sort of a vested interest in the old way, but you know, I'm convinced and confident that having this sort of master apprentice way of learning is really the ultimate, plus really fun. So anyway, not only have we getting applications from people that want to be apprentices, but also people that want to be masters. And I hate to just single out this one, because there have been incredible people that have been applying, but I'm going to share my screen and show you this guy. So his name is Benjamin Von Wong. He's actually really new on Google Plus. I just looked him up. He's like, plus Von Wong. There's two of them, so it's confusing. There's two Von Wongs. Maybe one is an imposter. But I mean, look at this crazy stuff that he does.
I think the real Von Wong is in the event tonight. He's been typing.
The real Von Wong is in the event. Oh, good. Yeah, that's him. So everyone should circle him up, and we'll put him in the show notes and stuff. This guy's crazy. I think he's a young guy. Of course, it doesn't matter how old you are.
Beautiful.
I don't care about that. But, man, I don't know where he comes up with these ideas.
He's got to lose some of those watermarks, though.
Well,
I'm kidding.
We can have a fight of the masters.
Cage match.
Yeah, cage match. And man, it's so cool. So
look
cool.
At that.
Anyway, this guy's great. Yeah, and if you guys want to be master, just I'll open it up to comments and on the blog or whatever. Let me know, and we can try to maybe get him in there. So he's one of these sort of inception masters, one of these people that we start with. Okay, right. So let's share photos. I'll go last. I have a bunch of new photos that I took with this while I was out learning to paraglide at the same time. So nice. I'll show you some of those. Right, but I'll go last. Who wants to go first?
Who's going to get the honors?
This is like Jeremy should go.
This is like school where the teacher then calls on somebody. No one's volunteering. Come on. Well, you all have great stuff to share. Come on.
I will happily go first because I was not prepared and didn't know we were showing photos, so I have nothing to show. I've got zero.
Well, even if you have, Jeremy, even if you've got you know, a website or something, you want to do screen sharing on something out there, that'd be awesome.
Man, I've got my website. I don't even know how to share. I'm not a Google. I don't know how to do this stuff.
I tell you, I'll go while he looks at that.
You go, and Pete, you show him how to do it in chat, and if you want to, Jeremy, you can use your carefully allotted time instead to promote Help Portrait.
Go.
Want to. Yep. You can show that website and talk about what you've been up to, because I know the big event just happened, so that's another thing you could talk about. But chances are that everyone watching has already seen you know, all your awesome photos, even though we don't mind seeing them again. It's like listening to a Grateful Dead tune. All right, go on, Thomas.
All right, so what I've been working on, I'm about 3 years behind on my processing. So it's kind of like the stuff that I'm doing now is stuff from 3 years ago, but it's the stuff that I'm doing now. So it's new to me, and it's new to everybody. Nobody's seen it. So I've been working these past couple of weeks on a Detroit trip from 2010. And so I'll share a few from those. Let's see, is the screen working?
We still see you.
You still see me?
Yep.
You don't see the screen?
I see you. Over.
Let me try this again. I'm seeing
now,
the screen.
Now we see it.
Screen? Okay, so Detroit is an interesting place. It's you know, probably the most abandoned place in the United States. And so one of the places we got into was the Detroit Book Depository, which is this old place in Detroit where all the school textbooks ended up. And it's kind of been abandoned now, and they've all been rotting and falling apart. And so these are a few photos from that. This is just sort of the main floor area. Those are just rotting books. And here's some more just books everywhere on the floor, all strewn about everywhere. And on the top floor, there are actually skylights, and the skylights have all been broken, and so seeds from trees have fallen into the top floor, and the trees have started to take over the building on that floor. So these are trees actually growing out of a building.
Wow.
I thought that was kind of interesting, yeah. And again, here's some more, you know, you can see a little tree there on the left that's starting to grow, sprout out of the books, and just books and books and books everywhere, mostly all school textbooks.
That's in my son's bedroom.
Yeah.
There's a book I read, I think it was by the last name McKibben. It was about After Us, or The World Without Us, that's it.
Uh-huh.
And it talks about how nature will just completely take over any civilized part that, you know, once humans are gone, it'll just take it back over.
Yeah.
I'm going to look it up.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that's true. Down in the basement, this is an old sort of metal staircase down to the basement. They actually found a guy's body down there.
Ah.
They really beefed up security after that, so we had to use ladders and stuff to get into this place.
Was it Billy Wilson's conjoined twin?
Yes. No. No. I think it was like some homeless guy, and there were some guys. The story, it's online. There's an article about it. They were like urban explorers, and they were like playing ice hockey in the basement because it freezes over in the winter. And all of a sudden, they see these guys' legs sticking up like out of the ice.
Oh, God.
And so they didn't want to call the police because it's illegal to be in this place, of course. And but they called a reporter. And so the reporter came out, and there's like pictures of these guys, this guy's like legs sticking out of the ice online. But they wrote like a whole article about it, about this building. And then this is another side of Detroit, because Detroit isn't all dead. And this is, there's a famous architect, one of my favorites, Mies van der Rohe, who, you know, sort of is the less is more of the modern architecture world, and did, he's done a lot of the big box skyscrapers and stuff like that in Chicago and Toronto, and he has a, there's a residential building in Detroit where people actually live, and that's, this is a photograph of that. He's a wonderful, wonderful architect.
Very cool.
So that's what I'm going to share.
Nice.
Awesome possum. All right.
Lisa?
Oh, okay. My turn.
Your turn.
So let's see if I've got this. Can you see?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
There we go. Great.
So speaking of iPhone photos, this is a photo that I took
growing up as a little girl.
Yeah.
One of her childhood photos.
So this I took this on a world trip where I just shot exclusively with my iPhone, and this is a moment that probably wouldn't have happened with a DSLR because I sort of had a really I had a relationship with this girl in this moment. She was very comfortable with me just sort of sitting there, and I just kind of, you know, quietly snapping some photos. And there were kind of photographers around me that were kind of had big cameras, and she kind of didn't like that. And so it was a very peaceful moment, and something I think probably wouldn't have been captured if I didn't have my iPhone. So I've been shooting some stuff around where I live now, just north of Victoria, and getting some spectacular sunset and landscape stuff. And last year I took a trip to Patagonia, which honestly, if you haven't been, it has to be on your list. I know actually Trey's photos inspired this trip because he took some amazing shots of this place, Perito Moreno, in Patagonia, Argentina, and it just, I mean, you can't go wrong. I could have taken this with a BlackBerry. No offense. But just such an incredible place, and I actually used a rented lens for this shot, the 14mm, which was just so gorgeous. I haven't bought it yet, but I think it's perfect for something like this. I've also been trying to shoot some wildlife, and here's my friend Splashy. We're pretty good friends because I feed him fish. And he comes by, and I take shots of him. And
that's a good way to make a friend, feed him fish.
Hey, works for me.
And I've also been spending a lot of time in Hawaii, which is really a place with such dramatic landscapes, just everything from just these like incredible picturesque beaches to stuff like this. Like, I'm kind of obsessed with volcanoes now after seeing something like this. And this shot was kind of, I was scrambling in the bushes for quite a while to get this shot. it was pretty incredible. But you also get moments like this, just such a beautiful, and of course I was just so lucky, because otherwise the shot would be kind of boring, but she, this little girl ran in front of my frame, and it was just so incredible.
Wonderful self-portrait.
I also spent some time in Scotland last year, and it was just the worst weather. I've never been so cold, and I'm from Canada. It was actually snowing and these large hail-type snow when I was filming this. And but just the wet snow on the ground created this reflection, and it was just incredible. So those are some of my shots recently.
Beautiful. Awesome. I love that one of the volcano, especially, well, all of them. I'll just point that one out because of the thing you did with the little tree. That was really smart.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the instinct is to, I guess, just to fill the frame with the hole that you put the tree.
Yes,
on.
Exactly. And that's why I was scrambling the bushes. And I was really happy I had my my headlamp for that shot.
Yeah, very smart.
Light painting. Jeremy?
Jeremy.
So I am on my wife's laptop, and I still don't have any images. So I'm okay. I can talk about images. I will talk about help portrait for a second. We did have our 5th year anniversary this last year, and you know, for anyone who's listening, it would be cool to see people get involved because there's no agenda, there's no money in this nonprofit, it's really just about giving, you know, your time and energy. And this past weekend, I got to see a 50-year-old woman get her first photo ever with Santa Claus after living her whole life on the streets. So it's like it's unbelievable. I mean, it's beyond words to see people get their first portraits in their lives. I mean, I had probably 10 people this week tell me their only picture they've had of themselves was from jail, you know, their mugshot. And so, you know, to take the experience that I give to celebrities and to give hair and makeup makeovers to, you know, people in need on the streets and, you know, children's hospital and all the people we've gotten to help this past weekend, it's pretty phenomenal. And people participated in over, I think, 30 countries is the last number I heard this past weekend. So it's really gone global. And this whole month, photographers around the world are doing these events. And so, yeah, it's pretty cool. So if anybody's listening and is curious to hear more, just go to help-portrait.com. You can check it out.
If you'd like, I can bring it up on a web browser here, Trey, if we want to do
that.
Yeah,
bring it up.
Sure.
Dash portrait, Jeremy?
Yeah, we kind of named it after the idea of a self-portrait. You know, self-portrait has the dash in it, so it's help-portrait. But helping others instead of ourselves, that's the idea behind it.
Right on. So,
yeah. Powerful stuff.
Cool. Can you find it, Pete?
Yeah, I've got it here. I'll go ahead and screen share. Okay?
Just so all right, here we go. Yeah, go for it. Yeah.
Rock and roll.
How's that?
Okay, I got your screen on. Whoa, 34,000. Over 2,000 photographers. 500 hairstylists.
Mm. Yeah, this year was actually our slowest year to date just because we've all been so busy as the leadership. But last year, I think we did 80,000 portraits in our weekend event. Wow. And so, as any of you know, like volunteer movement, I mean, it's hard to do. There's only three of us doing this after family, after hours, after our job. So it's crazy. Then if you scroll down, I think we have the total date statistics to date, which should be down there somewhere.
Right here?
No, even under that.
Oh, down here?
Yeah, total to
date. Oh, here we go, the total progress, yeah. 282,000?
Yeah.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's been amazing to see
great.
Do you actually print up photographs for them, or do you just give them digital?
No, we print on the spot. We print and frame right there on the spot. It's crazy.
Wow.
Yeah. Oh, that's wonderful.
We feed them. We bring Santa. We bring clothes. So they get fed. They get clothed. They get their hair and makeup done. I mean, it's a full-on day of glam. It's pretty amazing.
I can attest to how awesome the operation is. It's amazing. It's volunteer-based. I did it in Austin, and I showed up. And it's not. I didn't have low or high expectations. I just had no expectations. But I was blown away because cool. I think like it's the thing that impressed me the most. This is a weird thing to impress me, but they just had all these tables all lined up, and they had all these makeup cosmetic people, and they you know they have these things that look like toolboxes, these large metal things that are all shiny, and they layer out, and there were like 10 of them lined up, and there were all these people lined up. It was like it looked like an iPhone factory. It was unbelievable.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah, I wish like I could. You've got a hashtag here too. Help portrait. If people want to follow on Instagram.
Yeah, exactly.
Nice.
And it's been fun with OKDOTHIS because now we have all these different do's. You know, like show your hair and makeup team at work. Share one of the most powerful stories, so we can really, essentially dissect a hashtag into many different little ideas and see all the responses. See those ideas have been really cool. I wish I could show some of my recent shoots. I've been doing some celebrity shoots in the last few weeks, but they'd kill me if I showed those images before they're released. But yesterday I got to shoot the girl from the show Nashville, Hayden Panettiere.
From Heroes.
I'll show them anyways. Who cares?
I spent all day with Hayden yesterday. There's a pretty funny picture on my Facebook of her doing my makeup. And so, but yeah. That's a bummer about shooting the celebrity stuff. You have to wait almost a year most of the time before you can show it, because, you know, until they publish it or release it, it's pretty frustrating, but that's the life.
Well, come back and show us.
All right.
Hey, there's a comment here. Let me share the screen. Actually, now people think this is the thing I was talking about. It's called the narrative clip. A tiny automatic camera and app that gives you a searchable and shareable photographic memory. Yeah.
So looks like you can buy that one now, huh? It's not a Kickstarter.
Yeah, it's like it's available. All right. I'll unscreen share that and re-screen share my photos. Okay, this first one I'm going to show you is not from the Sony A7. By the way, I've been taking a ton of A7 shots. I've probably taken 1,500. But the little grouping I'm going to show you today is just from the paragliding stuff. But this first one's not paragliding. It's just a new one that I kind of like. It's weird.
You're a fan of the A7, huh, Trey?
Big fan. Big fan. Yeah. I bought one, and I love it. I love it. Okay. But I still get to know it. You know, it's like a new car or something. You're still getting to know it. But I
like a new girlfriend, right?
I don't know, Thomas. I don't know. Now, this is Sydney, and it's kind of a weird photo, but I like it. I went out there on the deck to shoot, and it was kind of neat, but I decided to step inside and shoot from inside where the glass was reflecting all the weird stuff back. I like not being sure what's in the front and what's in the back and having it not really matter. And
that's what she said, right?
Well played, T-Hawk.
I better stop with the wine. All right. I'm sorry.
Yeah. This is in the front part in the back, Thomas Hawk.
Yes.
Now, here's a shot from behind, Thomas. This is with the new Sony. This is what it looks like up at about 5,000 feet. And so I made a video, and I'm going to release it. It's for the Arcana, but I'll release it everywhere. It's going to be a really weird video. It's me learning to use the Sony A7R while I'm learning to paraglide. Because on my second day of training, I actually jumped off this peak, which is one of the highest peaks in the Southern Alps. And like before I would jump, I would kind of calm my nerves by taking photos of my friends that were also jumping. So there, that's what that looks like from up there. This is one of my friends I was jumping with. This is taken with, I think, the 35mm 2.8 lens, which is quite a small little lens. It's all full frame, of course. His name is Chris Madison, and he actually is my neighbor here. And he lives about 200 feet from me, or a two-minute walk. And he has a new yoga and wellness retreat that he's opening down in Glenarchy, which is less than an hour away, called Aroha.
The nice thing about taking a picture of him, Trey, is you don't have to wait a year like Jeremy's.
Right.
Exactly.
This is my master. This is my paragliding master. Basically, this guy is sort of the wind and cloud whisperer, and he's got this really authentic British accent. Whenever people tell me anything with a non-American accent, I always believe them because it just sounds so gosh darn authentic. Anyway, he's standing up here and kind of watching the wind, and it's getting late in the day, and there are all these thermals coming up that I couldn't see, but he could just see everything. I'm learning slowly to see it. But actually, I'm finding that I'm learning out a lot more about clouds, and even though I watch clouds all the time. This is my friend Chris. This is him, getting some of the... You have to make sure that all these lines are laid up exactly correct, and all the straps are just right. Otherwise, things get tangled, and then things go bad. You're going to have a bad time. This is a HDR shot that I took right off the edge of the mountain. That's the Remarkables in the distance, and Queenstown off to the right, and Arrowtown to the left, and Dale Field in between. Actually, kind of if you just click right in the middle of that photo, that's where I'm broadcasting to you from right now. That's sort of that middle area where I live in between those two places. Here's Chris getting ready to go. And, I've been using the NEX-7 for so long. It's okay with depth of field, but, you know, nothing compares to full frame depth of field. So I'm happy to have something full framey once.
Trey, have you tried any of those lens adapters with the A7 yet?
Well, yeah, I've got the Leica one on, and that's great. And I also have one for the Sony Alpha lenses. But you'll see this in the video that's upcoming. I try on all this different stuff and show you how to hook it up. Yes. Now, this is on the training hill. This is Chris on the training hill. So the hills get more and more steep. This is like one of the introductory hills where you're running around and just kind of getting it up above you and feeling what it feels like. This is another shot off the top of Coronet Peak. This is Chris kind of sitting there in the grass. I think this is taken with a 50 millimeter f1.8. It's a prime lens, prime fixed lens.
Sony makes that with the A7?
What'd you say?
That's Sony's 50 millimeter with the A7?
Yeah, that's right. It's called the FE system, the full frame E mount. It's super tiny. Next time I'll bring it in and I'll show you how tiny it is. This is us kind of hanging out on the training hill. This is an HDR shot. And this was taken with the Sony Alpha lens, the wide one. I think it's 16 to 35. And it's a big old, you know, fatty daddy lens because it's the old DSLR system, right? So it looks kind of strange on top of such a small camera, but it works. And that's because they don't have a good wide-angle lens yet for this. I don't think they will for another 6 months, so I just have to use this giant Sony one in the meantime. Here's another one of my teacher instructors, a nice guy named Blake. This is a shot down the training hill. We kind of sit here, but I think I sat here for like 2 hours, just kind of waiting for the wind and just looking at all the contrails. They're not contrails, I guess they're just cirrus clouds, because no planes fly over here. We're so far south, we never see planes fly overhead, except for the ones that take in and out of the airport, but they're quite low. So this is what it looks like right when you get going.
You never see them because you're usually in your private jet, Trey, flying.
here's what it looks like right as you get going. You got to run full speed because you have to get going, you know, I think something like 15 or 20 kilometers an hour before you actually get off. And then this is what it looks like. This is my friend right after he took off and kind of sailing out over the valley below. All right, there you go. I will now unscreen share.
Now, did you take some from up in the air when you were in the air as well?
I did. I did. Let me see if I can find it here. Published. Oh, no, hold on. We go here to photos.
You have a really organized Lightroom there, Jay.
Exactly. No, it's somewhat organized. No, this is iPhoto.
Stuff.
Really? Use iPhoto?
Yeah.
I put my final photos in iPhoto just because it syncs so well with my iPad and that kind of stuff. Hmm. Well, so this is the only photo I took from up there, but this was taken with Google Glass.
Yeah.
Now, he says that, so I get my, I already have my pilot's license, but I get certified after 40 more flights. But he said after 40 flights, I'll be good enough at it where I can just take my DSLR with me. And I can do a few tricks to hold on to the straps in one way, and I can just use my giant Sony to take proper pictures, even though I don't think this glass shot is so bad. But, you know, once you're
used to a
nice 36-megapixel camera, whatever you like to use.
So right now, as it stands now, you kind of got to use your hands to control this thing, so you can't really shoot?
Yeah. Yeah. I probably could let go, but it's an ill-advised maneuver at this nascent stage.
Tell him I said it was okay.
Yeah, I'll tell him my spiritual advisor, Thomas Hawk, says it's just fine.
It's worth it. Anything to get the shot, Trey.
Yeah. Cool. Well, what do you guys got going on this week? Anything you're looking forward to?
Well, hey, I thought I would. I did find one image I wanted to share with y'all.
Oh, right on.
All right.
That celebrity, isn't it?
It actually is a celebrity, but it's a really amazing story. Probably my favorite portrait, maybe my favorite portrait I've ever shot because of the story involved. So I was doing a shoot a few weeks ago for a new TV show. Tyler Perry, the very famous movie guy, is creating, and one of the cast members was John Schneider from Dukes of Hazzard, if y'all remember him, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm shooting John, and that morning he'd been doing all these impressions. He was like, here's my Richard Nixon, here's my Kennedy, my Reagan, and so he's really good at impressing and impersonations. And so we're doing the shoot, and he's dancing with the girl that's in the show, and they're bouncing off each other, having a blast. And so we finish the shoot. He walks off the set, and he says, you know what, can I take one more picture? And I said, well, yeah, of course. And so he walks back on set and starts weeping, like crying. And I was just thinking, like, who is this impersonation? And let me see if this is working. I'm hitting a start screen share.
Yeah, we see it.
You see the image?
Yes.
So he starts crying, like very believable. So much so that this is an 80 megapixel image, by the way. It's massive.
Whoa.
Yeah, sorry. I didn't mean to zoom in on
my hair.
Yeah, now I'm missing the point.
180 megapixel?
Yeah, it's insane. I'm totally losing the point of the story here. Let me try to zoom back out.
It's okay. We paused the story.
He could cry on demand, essentially, as an actor, is what you're saying.
Well, so he starts crying. I don't know why this is frozen up. He starts crying, and after a minute walks up to me and gives me a hug. And he said, really trying to get this thing to zoom in, because you need to see it when I tell you the story behind it. How do you use a browser? So anyway, he looks at me and says, my dad just died an hour ago.
Wow.
And hugs me and then walks off the set and was flying home that day. Wow. And so just an unbelievable moment as a photographer. Yeah, look at this. I don't know even what happened to the image. You can see the URL here. If you go to public.jeremycowart.com/have.jpg, that's where the image is sitting. But anyway, yeah, it was like that portrait will be one of my favorite images that I think I've ever shot, because he let me in on that moment. He let me in on this very, very private moment, and he wanted that captured. And so I think on a number of levels, that image will always be one of my favorite portraits.
Did you get to talk to him at all later when you showed him the portrait?
No, he left. I mean, he left immediately. He was flying home to, arrange stuff with his family.
And so has he seen the portrait?
He saw it right then, and the only thing he said was, that's my dad. He said, I look just like my dad. And then he was gone. That's the last I've talked to him.
Huh.
Yeah, it was.
That's great. That's, it's what it's all about.
And I'm sorry I ruined the story with a non-functioning laptop.
No, it's okay. Don't worry about it. But, we can see it now, actually. And I'm loading it up on my page. Dude, this is... I don't think my browser's ever worked so hard on a photo.
Oh, I know.
This is,
it's insane, the detail. And it was cool that I got to capture such a powerful moment with such a powerful camera. That's when everything's working together.
how long ago did that happen?
This is only a couple weeks ago.
A couple weeks ago, yeah.
What kind of lighting are you using there?
We had a big 7-foot octobank. I think it's Profoto. Always use Profoto strobes with just a basic rim light on the back.
Mm. But, I zoomed in on the eye here.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's fairly ridiculous, the detail there. But so that's my John story. Pretty powerful stuff.
That's great.
And I have so much respect for him. I mean, I haven't gotten his permission yet to officially share that on my website or blog, but I just know that, if he ever saw this, I mean nothing, but it's just inspiring to me that he let me in that moment, and I think it'll inspire anybody else that ever sees this image, because we all obviously can relate to such a meaningful thing to happen in our life. So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty powerful. I mean, the best photography is very powerful, and that's right up there.
Yeah. That's all I got.
Oh, thanks. What's next for you, Jeremy? What are you doing? What are you doing over Christmas? Any just family stuff, or you got any shoots coming up? What's going
on? We're really trying to slow down. I had a big shoot today. I'm exhausted. I had a big shoot, two big shoots this week, where I'm in app development mode, full on. Help portraits done. So now it's just really focusing in on the app and making that, growing that community, which I know will be a time consuming process. So I'm sure Lisa has lots of advice for me there, but yeah, that's the plan, is to work on the app and to hang out with family.
You, Lisa, what are you doing over the holidays?
Me? Well, I have always had a dream of shooting some snowy scenes in Banff and Lake Louise, so I've just been waiting. It was minus 33 Celsius. There just a few days ago, and I just thought I've spent the last few months in Hawaii. I got this hat though, so I think I might be good.
That's a good look for you, Lisa. That's a good Russian spy. I like that.
Yeah, I have played a Russian spy in many a internet video.
Jeremy, that's what you need to do, by the way. You need to play a Russian spy in a video for your, like Lisa did. That's what you
need back then. That's exactly the only way.
Exactly what I was thinking I needed to do. Yeah.
So I've got that trip, and obviously we've got some big plans for a new version of Camera Plus that we're hoping to release really, really soon. That's hopefully going to give Snapseed a run for their money. Just saying. So, and obviously there's lots of, drinking of the eggnog and eating massive amounts of chocolates.
Yes.
Oh, chocolate. We like chocolate.
Pete, what are you doing over the holiday?
Yeah, we're going to do a little bit here, and then we're in Northern Cal, and then we're going to head down to Florida, see my mom and family, but get some shooting in, and Marin up here, and some in Fort Lauderdale.
Excelente. Thomas, what's going on with you?
Yes, I'm going to Marfa, Texas. No, I'm just kidding. I wish. Marfa, Texas is on my list of things to shoot. No, I'm hanging out here with the family, the four kids and all that, and Merry Christmas, Grandma and Grandpa, and all that stuff.
Yes. Yeah, as for me, I am family stuff and also just playing a lot with a new camera. I'm going to do some shoots. It's not cold down here, it's the middle of summer. It's so weird, actually, because it gets dark. I mean, it must get dark here, 11 p.m., which is very late, and it gets bright super early, like 4:30 a.m.
Is it hot? So, what's the weather like?
No, it doesn't. Well, down here it doesn't get too hot. It might get up to maybe 75, but usually 70, around 21, 20 to 22 Celsius. It's sunny and nice.
That's still good for it.
Cool.
That's still good for some Speedo self-portraits, Trey.
Yeah, that goes to my... I'm so glad Instagram Direct is there now. I'll just send them right to you.
just between you and me. Just Instagram.
I think there's an app. Snapchat or something, maybe.
No, yeah, Thomas is the only reason I installed Snapchat. I'm his only contact. He's my only contact. We just Snapchat each other.
We go back and forth. It's like crazy. We're like batty like that.
Right. We're just a couple of randy teenagers, me and Thomas. Yeah.
Was that a
we
$3
need more than one contact
idea?
Each.
Just two good old boys.
Yeah.
So
I'm not doing anything. I'm just going to take a lot of photos and play around. And I am so Leica curious. I've got to really play with these Leica lenses. It's pretty exciting to me.
Maybe get that quadcopter. That'll be a nice gift for the holidays. Fly that thing around.
Yeah, I'm excited. I have some cool ideas with this quadcopter. I'm super excited about it, actually. Yeah. All right. Anything else before we wrap it up, Pete? Anyone want to say anything?
I think that's it. Unless we want to do a quick, quick close, let the audience know where they can find everybody. We can do that. Close it off.
Let's do that.
Start with
Thomas.
Starting with me, you can find me, just search Thomas Hawk on Google, but I hang out on Google+, and I hang out on Flickr, and I hang out on Instagram now. I need more Instagram followers. I like those people. They're very sweet. And wherever, I'm just Thomas Hawk.
Right on. Lisa?
Actually, when I was in Hawaii, I was purchasing something, and they always require photo ID, and I actually just said, just Google me. Trust me. Don't find me. There's like 10 million photos of me wearing 10 million different hats and various things. But yes, I am Lisa Bettany, mostly lisa.com. I don't blog anymore, and it's sad, but it's so hard, and I really hurt my neck badly being a bad computer user, an iPhone user last year, so I've had to limit my time online. So I try to post a photo every day on 500px or on Facebook, and I'll tweet that out, but I've had to limit my activities online because of that.
Right on. Jeremy?
You can find me at my website, jeremycowart.com, Twitter, Jeremy Cowart, and of course, OKDOTHIS, I'm at Jeremy. so it's in the App Store. You should check it out if you want to be inspired. That's our goal, is to inspire people. So that's it. Thanks for having me, y'all. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, we loved having everybody on the show. Thank you, guys.
All right. Bye,
Trey, we know where
thanks,
to find
everyone,
you.
For watching. We're reading all the comments and everything, and we'll post this. And, Pete, all these names that we mentioned tonight, iPhone photographers that people should follow. Don't forget Terry Lou Danzler. She's awesome, too. There's so many awesome people. But anyway, we'll put these guys in the show notes and get this shared out there. That sound good, Pete?
Sounds good.
All right,
everyone.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a good evening.
All right. Catch you later.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye. Whoops, I didn't click it. Now I'm clicking it. Whoa, look at Thomas drown that thing.
I know. I was home. I was thirsty. I was waiting for that one.
All that's left is foam and steam in that cup.
No, I barely got. I barely.